My name is Dr. David Jaffray. I'm a physicist, and I work at Princess Margaret Hospital in Toronto. Well, the physicist's role is an interesting one in the context of oncology, and specifically in radiation oncology. Radiation therapy is a way of treating cancer in patients, whether it's kids or adults. And it's a challenge to understand where the radiation goes. And physicists, they know about radiation. So in fact, there's about 30 physicists at Princess Margaret Hospital. And we have the job of commissioning and organizing and being confident that the radiation that's applied is actually accurate and correct. And our role is exciting because we work at an interface between the clinicians who have a clinical intent and the machines that actually deliver the radiation. And so we get to be involved on a case-by-case basis for difficult, challenging problems. But also in the background, we get to work in the laboratory, working on new systems and new devices to improve our ability to conform the dose to the target and avoid normal tissues. So my research involves improving every day for individual patients the delivery of their radiation therapy. And we do that by a variety of methods. We may come up with a better way to estimate the dose within the body, because that calculation isn't necessarily straightforward. Or we may come up with a way of imaging where the patient's anatomy is, because each day, you know, your anatomy can move around. You're breathing, your stomach is filling, your stomach is emptying. There are all kinds of things that can cause the location of a tumor or location of normal tissues within the body to change. And if we want to place the radiation dose in a precise and accurate way, that way we can avoid the normal tissues and concentrate the dose, it'd be great to have a way to visualize that within the human body each day before we treat. Yeah, one of the most sort of compelling cases that I came across when I was doing my PhD work was in positioning a small patient, a cancer patient. It was a young child, and we wanted to place radiation within the body, particularly in the brain, to treat a brain tumor. And the imaging systems we had at the time would not let us see the very soft bone that is bone in a child. And so we had to come up with all kinds of tricks, you know, marks on the patient's surface, and trying to estimate where the tumor was within the patient at the time of treatment. And that gave me this really strong desire to come up with an improved way to visualize the anatomy inside the patient, and so we could direct the radiation with greater precision and accuracy. It doesn't make any sense if we're going to, you know, induce a toxicity in a patient and miss the target. It just seems like a complete, you know, misstep. So if we can increase the precision and accuracy, we get better control and reduce toxicity. So that drove the development of a lot of the imaging systems that are now on the market. Well, radiation therapy is actually really heavily used to manage cancer. About 50% of the patients who have cancer will see radiation therapy over the course of their cancer management. And so in the province of Ontario, that's 60,000 people a year. We're talking about 20,000 to 30,000 patients will receive radiation therapy. And if each one of these, if we can increase the precision and accuracy of placing the dose, that's a large number of patients who will have a higher control rate, or in addition, a large number of patients will have a reduced toxicity. Because if we don't have precision and accuracy, if we can't target so well, we have to treat a larger volume. And as a result, more normal tissue gets irradiated unnecessarily. So these technologies can be rolled out into radiation oncology and impact the care of many, many patients. One of the developments that we managed to commercialize was the development of an imaging system that integrated directly with the radiation therapy unit. And the early systems, they had ability to treat, and you could use that treatment beam, it's a very high energy beam, to make an image of the patient, but the quality was very poor. And at the same time, we realized if we could produce a lower energy beam on the machine, we could have a better visualization of soft tissue anatomy inside the patient. So we worked with an industry partner who had a similar vision. They were very interested in improving the precision and accuracy. And in the late 90s, we demonstrated that if you used a certain combination of X-ray source and an X-ray detector, this combination, if applied appropriately, could be adapted to an existing treatment machine and allow us to make a CT image of the patient while they were in treatment position. That CT image could be produced very quickly, in about a minute, and at very high resolution, so you could see a lot of detail. The ability to visualize that on the machine gives us the ability to adjust the patient each day to make sure we're targeting in a precise and accurate fashion. So that was a very exciting development. We did a lot of bench work in the laboratory, convinced people that the imaging system would work. We then went through the process of convincing the hospital that we should drill holes in the front of the existing machine one weekend, and I remember very distinctly the director of the program coming in and saying, are we going to be treating on Monday morning? And we said, absolutely. But that was the kind of confidence that we were able to get from the administrative staff and support of the hospital to push these kinds of innovations forward. So in 2002, we reported in an article in the field the feasibility of doing this and the quality of images that could be produced. And that article precipitated a very strong response in the community. And we talked to the industry partner about, could we build one that was more standard that they could use in humans? This was just a research platform we were using at the time. And we could take images, but we couldn't direct therapy because it wasn't approved for that kind of use. And so we worked in a collaboration. The industry partner, who was out of the UK, they decided to build four prototypes. And at that point in time, I had just moved back to Canada. So we got one at Princess Margaret Hospital. One went to my old institution in the United States, where I used to work in north of Detroit. And another one went to the Netherlands Cancer Institute in Amsterdam. And the fourth one went to the Manchester in UK. And so these four systems were prototypic, but they were the early systems, and we were able to, you know, mature their use. And now those systems are becoming standard. In fact, all the vendors offer something similar, and there are over 1,000 of these systems now in use all around the planet. The first funding for it really came from a grant that we wrote to the U.S. government's Department of Defense funding for prostate cancer. There were some special funds allocated in the U.S. For the development of improved therapies for prostate cancer, and we applied for funding to make a prototype on the bench, basically something in the lab to convince us that it would work, and they gave us that funding. The success there let us go after some NIH funding, and we got two rounds of NIH funding to build the early prototype. And that funding was really critical because the industry partner knew that we had the funds to kind of do some more proof of principle and push it forward. They also realized that if they synergized with that activity, that would work to their benefit. And so we took the time to patent the technology, which is quite important to help industry get motivated to invest more in it. Because if you don't patent it, all the work that one industry partner does can just be taken by somebody else. And so patenting is a very useful method of creating a vehicle for investment. Because once you invest in it, you have an exclusive use of it. And that was an important step to get the industry partner on board. And after that, the industry partner was actually more interested. They would invest more, build the prototypes. And it's been a fantastic adventure since then, for sure. Because in many ways, it allowed us to come across new problems. No one had ever used this machine. No one knew how to use to check that the machine was going to be okay or not. So we built additional devices that were used to check that the machine was okay. And we licensed those to another company. And it was a whole series of opportunities that came from the idea that if you're first to see the problem, you're first to work on the solution. And you know, usually first attempts are not too bad. And so it's quite an exciting time, lots of innovation in the group. So there's many, many things that had to actually be in place to make an innovation like this make its way from an idea to a prototype, to a clinical prototype, and then on and to wide distribution. Some of it, of course, is funding. We had to write grants and get the funding to build the first prototype, which that took a lot of work. In fact, the first attempt at the grant was not successful, of course. And but you have to be confident that what you're doing is going to be valuable, and be resilient when those grants come back with a no, to go after them again or go after alternative funding. But we were pretty fortunate this way. Our second attempt for funding really went well, and then the third and fourth kept going. Other thing you need to make this happen is the hospital has to support what you're doing. The hospital could have simply said, you know, this machine's treating patients, why are you doing this? This is the standard of care. This is the way people treat cancer all over the world. Why can't we just deliver high quality, state-of-the-art care like the rest of the world? Why do we gotta do this? You know, we had to take the covers off the machine and drill these holes in them, for example, to mount this prototype. In fact, all of our data was named after long weekends, Thanksgiving, Memorial Day. These are all the data sets because that's the only time we can get enough time to install the device, do the tests, and remove it, and then so the machine could be used routinely in the following Monday or Tuesday. And so the hospital support for this is really key. In fact, the government, in funding the U.S. government in funding the first prototype, they required that the hospital take the risk, the insurance risk associated with the device hurting the patient, because the device wasn't an approved device per the FDA because of the modifications we were making. So the hospital had to actually pony up and say, well, we'll carry the risk. You really do need to have an environment that that supports this and sees the benefit of research in a hospital setting. I think one of the things I've learned is that you should collaborate to compete, really, in this front. You don't want to take all your ideas and say, these are my ideas, I've got it all figured out, because you know someone else has got that same idea somewhere. And instead of sitting on it and holding it, they've probably contacted two or three collaborators to work with, and they're gonna rock it forward. And there's nothing to be worse than when you're standing in the back of the room and you see a speaker presenting the exact same idea, and they succeeded because they found partners while you were sitting on your idea. When it comes to commercialization, we're near the point where there's some technology that you're going to actually send to market. Be conservative in your estimates of the value, and that's generally speaking a good idea. And if you think in your terms that you've negotiated that it's a really good deal for you, it's probably unrealistic. So you should really take a realistic view, because those expectations can actually build over time. And if those expectations are unrealistic, it'll just drive the relationship with the commercial partner apart. And so it's very useful, you know, and at the time it's nice to be excited that you're going to get, you know, a really strong return on this, but it's much better to be realistic and conservative. Because at the end of the day, it's not just that that doesn't happen, but it also disrupts the relationship because the expectations are misaligned. So I think it's quite important to be conservative in these kinds of estimations, and that'll assure the relationship. The end goal for the radiotherapy story in terms of image guidance is improving quality of care. And the fact that we were able to work with a partner to get the idea out of the lab, into the clinic, and broadly taken up, that's been fantastic. We've had to actually go a step further than building the technology. We had to, if that was the objective, to get into the clinic, we have had to go and build educational programs, actually. We found that the technology is so new that no one knows how to use it. If the technology is so new that nobody knows how to use it, then it's just going to take longer to get it into the clinical setting and working for the advantage of the patient. So one of the things we had to do was to find funding and support to build an educational program. Because our early experience was valuable to us, but we realized suddenly that the rest of the world wanted to know what we were doing with the systems. In healthcare, the developments really, I define success where we've changed practice. Like, impact factors are nice, and everybody likes to see those highly visible papers, but at the end of the day, you really want to know, are you treating patients differently? And so the developments we did with image guidance, I think they've been impactful. People are being treated differently. We're treating patients that we would have not even attempted to treat before. We know in retrospect that we missed in some patients, because we know that if we didn't have image guidance, we could see that we would have been off. And what percentage of those patients would have missed, what the impact was in terms of their control of their disease, it's hard to say exactly. But we know that with image guidance technology, we're more precise and accurate, and we apply the radiation dose exactly as we said we were going to do. And that's changed practice. Also, healthcare already has enough uncertainty in it. Every patient's going to respond differently. The cancer specifically is a very complex disease. The least we can do is have precision and accuracy in our intervention. And then we can maybe understand better what the causes of variability. If we find that if we have differences in outcomes for patients, maybe it's their genetics, but we absolutely know it wasn't that we didn't treat them the same way. So introducing something that's precise and accurate intervention should let us see deeper into other factors that are affecting outcomes. We're academics, so we go and present and report on our results at meetings, and that's a really powerful way to share information. And once they see our research, because our research is to build it, that's a very interesting research project on its own, they see it coming, and then they realize, what can I use that for? And that's how we've basically shared the information around the small animal radiator. That's how we shared the information around the first clinical system that we built, was we went and reported it at a major meeting, and that got the excitement going. And people started asking the company that we had put the original prototype on their machine. They started to be asked, are you going to make this? Are you going to sell this? If you make it, we'll buy one. And that just snowballs. understand the problem that you're trying to solve pretty well. If your innovations arise from a clinical problem, at least in the healthcare context, then you're in a much stronger position to take that through to a commercial endpoint. So really take the time to make sure you're on a problem of relevance, and don't just believe the first person you talk to. Ask a bunch of people and get a range of opinions about the value of that problem. And if you have a solution to that valuable problem, then you're on the right track. I guess the follow-on from that is that be critical, sort of self-critical, about whether you think something is really worth pursuing. Because the commercialization path is extremely time-consuming. It takes a lot of energy. It doesn't have a clock. You never know when you're going to get pulled into something. And you really want to go after something you think is worthwhile. So be selective. If you can find industry alignment early, I found that's very successful. I think that's a great way to go. Because I like where I am. I like doing what I'm doing. I don't see myself always taking something through to the market myself. But to find partners who I can work with to affect that is a great way to go. And that's just a personal decision on my part. I find that it can be very productive because I stay close to the problem set. I leverage my experience. And then I let the other people who do the commercialization extend that into the market. And I can support them through that whole path. And that's proven to be, I think, a very successful model. Stay close to the problem set. Validate your solution with others. Find an industry partner that you can work with. That doesn't mean that they're just going to give you money or they're going to pick up the technology. Someone you can really work with, because it ends up being a long-term relationship.